everybody. This is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical, and we're starting a webinar related to lung cancer today. We're fortunate to be joined by Jackie. Jackie is actually Jackie Rose Close, I think. Isn't that right, Jackie?
Yes, it is.
Oh, okay. I got confused by the Rose and the Close. Can you hear me?
I can.
I'd like to start with a quick presentation. And then we're going to get into an interesting case where a small cell lung cancer was being fought by Jackie, who's on the call as well, and we'll hear from her. So starting out, lung cancer epidemiology. Worldwide, lung cancer is the greatest cause of cancer deaths, with 1.1 million cases yearly. In Western countries, it's the second most common cancer, but it leads in terms of cancer deaths. Interestingly, before smoking and granted before widespread medical literature, it turns out that lung cancer was barely a recognized disease. It was incredibly rare, maybe only a couple hundred case reports. And granted, you know, people didn't always know what you were dying of before the 1920s, but nowadays it's hardly rare. Risk factors, as people should know, smoking is pretty high up there. There are different carcinogens in smoking, and so you can take your pick, but it's pretty clear that smoking does cause lung cancer. Smoking also depresses the immune system, which is our primary way of fighting cancer. Also, the risk of cancer is proportional to the amount of time smoked. And after you stop smoking, actually the risk starts to drop again. So there's always hope for those who have been smoking for a long time. Another big one is radon exposure. Radon is a naturally occurring substance in the earth. But as it decays, it releases radiation. And perhaps one in 15 homes has pretty high levels of radon. So that's something that you wouldn't normally think is significant. I think people know asbestos is related to mesothelioma, which is a rare subtype of lung cancer. But being around particulate matter, say being a coal miner, in dusty areas, industrial areas, smog in certain areas around the world. Around LA, it used to be that you couldn't even see because of the smog prior to unleaded gasoline. So all these things are risk factors. There's also a viral component in some primates. And this is SV, a simian virus. CMV was one of the viruses we talked about last week. It's implicated in grinding down our immune system. And the studies on the TA-65 cohort showed that the improvements that were achieved while taking TA-65 seemed to be the most pronounced on those that were CMV infected. CMV is a chronic indolent infection that you just don't shake, you live with. But among those people, the burnt out T-cell fraction decreased pretty significantly. And that's something that if you're interested in, you should check out the webinar that I did with Dr. Bill Andrews, which was really interesting, and he's a great wellspring of knowledge. The symptoms of lung cancer are kind of nonspecific. I think it's more the time course that should be concerning. The symptoms are coughing, with or without blood, shortness of breath, wheezing. If some of the airways are affected, then you can get wheezing, chest pain. Also referred pain, which is one of Jackie's presenting symptoms, and then non-specific cancer symptoms such as weight loss, fatigue, loss of appetite. You can also have difficulty swallowing, hoarse voice, and there are various paraneoplastic syndromes, which just means something associated with having a cancer that can be somewhat specific to lung cancer, and there's something that we won't really go into, but they can present in odd sort of ways. That's what you really need to know. So for the classification of lung cancer, there's two kinds. The majority 80% are called non-small cell lung cancer. And these include squamous cell, adenocarcinoma, and large cell. The kind that Jackie had was a small cell. It used to be called an oat cell lung cancer. And these come from special neuroendocrine cells, which grow in the large airways. Their function being, when they sense a low oxygen count, they're able to neurologically adjust certain factors to make the shunting of the blood and make the breathing more efficient. So, of course, when you're taking carbon monoxide, you get hypoxia. These cells are very active. And so, as with any cancer theory, the more you use a cell type, in general, the higher the risk. So this is very pathognomonic or very specific to smokers, the small cell cancer. As we discussed in previous lectures or webinars, there's chromosomal damage which factors in. And those frequently affected are the short arm, that's designated by P, of chromosome 3, long arm of 5, long arm of 13, and long arm or short arm of 17. And of course, as Bill discussed last week, the short arm of 17 is where P53 lives. And P53 is the master policeman of your DNA. And so 75% of the time, you must find this mutation or this damage in the lung cancer cells. The staging of lung cancer is done by a TNM system, which just means you look at the size of the tumor, if any nodes are affected, and if there are metastasis or spreading of the cancer to other sites besides the lungs. But that's just for non-small cell. And the reason small cell and non-small cell are differentiated is because of mainly prognostic reasons. Non-small cell lung cancer, although not good, they typically have the same prognosis and treatment, whereas small cell is typically considered a non-curable disease. At this time, there's really no adequate treatment for it. So they stage it in two ways. One is limited stage, which means that it's limited to one single potential X-ray field, or extensive. The treatment is not surgical because the tumor spreads rapidly to distant sites, so it's primarily chemotherapy-based. And if there are metastases, then radiation can be given as well, and it's not uncommon to offer the patient prophylactic cranial radiation, which just means whole brain radiation in order to destroy any potential micrometastases that are there but not evident. Finally, the treatment becomes palliative. In other words, there's local X-ray to metastasis, potentially gamma knife or stereotactic surgery to this. But the median survival is only 6 to 12 months, meaning after 6 to 12 months, half the people have succumbed, half will still be in the fight. Hi, Jackie, can you hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Oh, perfect. So I'm going to go ahead and launch into this, but feel free to jump in if I don't get something right, okay?
Okay.
So Jacqueline was a 48-year-old ICU nurse. She had smoked for a while, and at this time in her career, she was doing locum tenens, which means that she would work at different hospitals.
Summer, I stayed in Chicago. And
right,
then and
I got back.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's smart, yeah. So you had, for people that don't know, ICU stands for intensive care unit, and that's where, of course, the most sick people go. And oftentimes, although not always, the most sick people are people who can have terminal diseases like cancer. So she has a long history of knowing what it's all about.
Right.
So that must have been really tough when you heard that you had been diagnosed.
I was stunned, to say the least.
Well, okay, so let's get the case out, and then we'll talk. So you had repeated PPD testing, which is the tuberculin testing, which all health workers, teachers need to take, and that required chest x-rays because there was a mild positivity, and they had always been normal. He came out to Chula Vista, and they got this awful phone call saying that your last x-ray was not normal. This is not yours, but it's a similar type of thing. It was showing that you had a 3-centimeter mass back in July of 2009, close to the center tree of the lung. Is that correct?
Right. Yes.
Right. So at that time, the workup would have been bronchoscopy. They take a tube and look down your trachea and go to the area of the tumor and try and poke through and or biopsy a visible lesion, which was not satisfactory. But they had also, in the metastatic workup, seen that her thoracic vertebrae number 5, just below probably the shoulder blades, had a bone, what appeared to be a bone metastasis. They biopsied it. It turned out to be small cell. So obviously the tumor here, if it went to the bone, had to be small cell. So there was no longer necessary to get tissue from here.
Right.
She had symptoms of paresthesias, which just means it could mean a tingling or a numbness, like a pins and needles in the chest.
Yeah, it was numb, totally numb.
Numb. And which part of which dermatome was that?
It was like a 4-inch band that went right across the upper chest.
I presume on the left.
All the way around.
Oh, all the way around. Okay.
Yeah.
So that the reason for that would obviously be T4 to T5 is where the vertebrae are, and so the nerves that come out of the spinal cord are being somehow affected, the sensory nerves. So she had an MR of the brain, and that was negative at that time, and I guess they offered, but you declined whole brain radiation as a preventative measure. At that time, you were still kind of thinking about going back to work.
Right.
Yeah, so the CT of the spine showed a 4.4-centimeter lesion 2 months after the initial chest x-ray, and it had begun to compress the thecal sac and the spinal cord. So that was quickly becoming more and more symptomatic with the paresthesia.
Right. Yeah, it was within probably about a 2-week period that I went from being at work and not having any symptoms to actually not even be able to sit up anymore because the pain in my back was so bad.
Wow. So this is not, so that's why small cell, of course, so aggressive, so rapidly growing. You know, Tracy, who's the daughter. Are you on, Tracy? I guess you guys are.
I can put her back on
no,
speaker.
No worries. I think it's better this way right now.
Okay.
But she had known and been seeing a Dr. Robert Wilson, Chicago, and she felt that alternative and complementary medicine would be a good way to also help fight the cancer.
Right.
But Jackie being, you know, allopathically oriented, medically science, kind of was never on board with the whole oriental medicine and all that, so she declined. Just by kismet, Dr. Wilson, Tracy's doctor, met Dr. Shima on, I think, a bus in January 2010. And the conversation really impressed Dr. Wilson, and he came back thinking, this is definitely something that Tracy's mom should think about.
Right.
He's 5, that is. So that was just totally, I guess, kismet, right? Just.
Yeah, talk about, you know, fate slapping you in the face and ignoring it.
Well, I mean, despite everything you know about the prognosis, you felt like, you know, maybe your chance would be different. Maybe the chemo would help, and right? I mean, doesn't everyone feel that when they get cancer?
Well, sure. Everybody thinks that, you know, medicine, you go in because you're sick and you get medicine and then you feel better. And you know, it's unfortunate. I know that that's not the case, but you still want to believe that that's what's going to happen.
Sure. Well, of course, you had 8 cycles of chemo. I think it was carboplatin etoposide.
The first cycle was, there were 4 cycles to each treatment.
Right.
The first one was cisplatin and etoposide.
Okay, so then you couldn't leave the house because you bottomed out in terms of your immune suppression, so you were stuck at
right.
home, kind of the boy in the bubble. And then
yeah.
it was really, I assume, a low energy, kind of a low quality of life at that time.
It was very, very poor. It was everything I could do to get out of bed and sit in a chair all day. It was, I had no life.
Wow, it's terrible. And as we discussed, Jackie was on a couple of weeks ago with Lila, another of Dr. Shima's patients. You know, the energy is one of the hardest things that hits you when you get the chemo. Because, of course, it's killing all your active cells, too, which are giving you that vitality.
Right, and it took probably a good 4 or 5 months before I started feeling well enough that I could actually go out and do things.
Sure. So what you're doing with chemo, of course, if people don't know, it's basically writing DNA errors. The cisplatin and the carboplatin, they write in DNA errors. And the etoposide is a kind of drug that makes DNA errors by interfering with an enzyme called topoisomerase, which is just something required to fold up and organize the DNA. So that's the state of cancer treatment for this disease in small cell. We just go in and poison everything and hope that the bad guys get more poison and that the good guys will recover. But unfortunately, in April of 2010, the tumor, which had shrunk, was coming back to 2.7, and it's shown here. This is your actual film.
Right.
So had the, obviously the tumor had probably helped shrink it destroyed the spinal mat, and did that help your chest numbness?
It did. Yeah, the chest numbness went away, and the back pain was no longer there.
So clearly, you know, some improvement there, but unfortunately, this being a very aggressive tumor, it was coming back by April, so that's about 7 months in. So you're already doing pretty well, relatively young, not a lot of comorbid disease.
None. I have no other comorbidities at all.
But that's always hard. So, of course, as part of that workup, the chest was showing 2.7 mass, and then a new finding was the brain metastasis.
Right.
Were you having symptoms from that?
I really wasn't. I think it probably started to bleed shortly before I went in for my scan because I did develop a slight nagging headache.
Right.
Probably about a week before I went in for the scan. So, but other than that, I really didn't have any symptoms at all.
Which is amazing because, you know, even to the layperson, when you look at this image, it just looks like a huge cannonball
right.
here. In your,
yeah.
I think it's the perhaps the right parietal lobe, maybe the left. You can never tell with these things. But
I think it's right.
That's right. So it's a 3-centimeter mass with bleeding, and there was also a 1.7, which I'm not sure is in this cut. I don't think it is.
It's not. I
yeah.
couldn't get a clear picture of that one, but.
So April, mid-April, the Ides of April, you decided to take a new direction. At this point, you said, well, I don't have much to lose. I have a brain met. Time to consider what Tracy's been saying.
Right.
And you did at this time take whole brain, which I know you had perhaps some bittersweet feelings, maybe thinking if you'd done that earlier, you would never would have gotten the met.
Of course.
Hard to say in retrospect, you know.
Right.
And so you start on the high-dose TA-65, and you also go in for another 4 of carboplatinum and etoposide in June.
Right.
And some good news. Which is why we're on this call. In August, the summer, a PET scan showed that the lesion had shrunk.
Yeah, it's pretty amazing, isn't it?
That's not really what we would expect, especially if the cancer had grown after you know, platinum etoposide. Another four is usually not going to be much different. It becomes resistant. But the best news of all, where the metastatic disease, this just blew me away. I mean, this is you 4 months after the original cannonball in your head, and it looks pretty darn good.
Yeah. It's
so the 3 centimeter was down to this tiny remnant healing, and the other tumor was not visible anymore. And this was four months after.
Right.
So, I mean, tell me what you were feeling at that point. I mean, I'm sure you weren't expecting that.
I wasn't. I was just hoping at least that it would stop the bleeding, you know, that during the radiation would stop the bleeding. I wasn't expecting to get a result like that. I was absolutely amazed.
Yeah, as I'm sure 99 out of 100 oncologists, if they were on the call, would be. And so fast forward, clinically stable. In October, you had the lung tumor was now 1.2 centimeters small, and they did something unusual. They offered you radiation locally for 4 weeks to try and control that.
Right.
What was the decision there, do you think?
Well, they were, you know, my oncologist was so pleased with the results that I was having at that point. Those tumors, you know, both of them being almost 4 centimeters and having it down to one, to her it was just amazing. And she said, this is not something that we normally do, but because your results have been so phenomenal, we're going to try it and see if that helps to stop it from growing.
Yeah. And so last month you had another scan. It was basically the same one, 2 centimeters. There was an enlarged lymph node close to the heart, which they think was outside the radiated field. And
right.
And you're up for another scan this month.
Next week. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Are they going to do a CAT scan, a PET scan?
They're going to do a PET scan and an MRI.
And how do you feel? I mean, you know how you feel. Do you feel
strong? I do. I feel fine. You know, my energy level is back. I don't really have any kind of symptoms of having cancer. You know, I don't have the coughing, the bloody secretions. I don't have any of that. My head feels okay. I don't have any headaches. And overall, I feel good.
That's amazing. Well, I put these pictures up because you sent me them. After 18 months and 8 cycles of chemo, which is heavy duty, brain, and then a local chest x-ray, this is you before on the left. This is you currently. And it's obviously much, much different lighting. But you look good. And the skin looks quite good, actually. Have you noticed any improvement in the quality of your skin?
I have. And even my children tell me that I'm looking younger than they are.
That's crazy. Well, you know, the TA-65, of course.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's helping the immune system. It's also helping the skin, which is a telomerase positive organ.
Right.
So I just thought I'd put this in there. So she was kind of the start and kind of the whole point of this. And it's really wonderful that she was able to get you connected with Dr. Shima. And so...
Yeah, and it happened in such a roundabout way. You know, like I said, this is fate slapping me in the face, telling me do this now. What are the odds that she would have spoken to somebody who then in turn got caught on a shuttle bus with the one person that could help me out with this and explained the whole case to him and came back with this information? It was just, it's one of those it was meant to be things.
So here, I mean, it's such a roller coaster when you get cancer or a loved one, and especially I know when my father was diagnosed with brain cancer, being a physician, you see the journey ahead and you're scared of it, of course. But
sure.
Now you're on this journey and you're just seeing these ridiculous improvements. And so what is that like spiritually for you emotionally?
Well, emotionally, it's just awe-inspiring. You know, I can't really describe what it means emotionally. It's giving me that much more time with my family, which is something that I feel is very important. You know, spiritually, I'm thankful that I'm getting this time. And whether it be from the chemo, from the TA-65. It doesn't matter to me where it's coming from. I'm just glad that I have it.
Absolutely. And the quality of life is good. It's, if you just do the chemo and you get a result, it can hurt really. I mean, and that's just the nature of our, the best we can do right now. But Lila said, and I think you echo, that you actually get so much good energy, healthy energy from taking TA-65.
Yeah,
you want to be. Yeah, you want to be in life and participating.
Right. It has almost like a calming effect to it. It's hard to describe, but you just feel very centered. You feel like you're able to control the things in your life. You know what's important and what isn't, and you can let those unimportant things go. And I think that it has a big, that TA-65 has a big effect in helping that to happen.
I mean, and of course, you know, we're both cynical, doctor type medicine, biomedicine, allopathic. So, you know, I'm with you. I generally am very skeptical of alternative and complementary methods, but you know, whatever the reason, who cares, right? Placebo effect.
Right.
As long
exactly.
As you're
even if it
disease,
is, it doesn't matter.
I'll take it. I know. I feel the same
way.
Well,
you know, I spent so much time looking for a reason not to take this at all. You know, my daughter was really pushing it, and I did a lot of research on trying to find out, you know, is this going to actually accelerate my cancer cells, and is it a good thing for me or not? And after the brain meds, I just reached the point where it doesn't matter anymore.
Right. Well, it helped
you
make the decision. That was so hard to do. But,
right.
Yeah, I mean, I thank you so much. You sent me all these citations from medical journals. And I guess the interesting thing is, this is something that's been studied, astragalus extract in cancer patients.
Right.
And there were a lot of studies that have been done that I was not even aware of that you gave me showing improvement. But, of course, the last paragraph is always, of course, more studies will need to be done.
So right.
Why aren't the studies being done? And the answer is follow the money, because there's no drug company that in the world that would spend money to develop a natural extractable product. It's not something that can be patented. And as cynical as that sounds, there's no way to make money on, like, vitamin C from rose hips. So why even start that journey?
And that's really a shame. And I think it's a statement for the Western medical community that if there is no money in it, then there's no reason to pursue it. That's really a negative statement. And
it almost
looks like they're wanting to keep you ill.
Well, I'm not sure it's so sinister as that. It's just, you know, you have to follow the money. And, of course, the biggest players at the lobbyist table are the insurance companies and the drug companies. And their incentives are not always directly in line with the doctors, let alone the patients. So, anyway, this is kind of what I think of the whole system from 10,000 feet. You know, you were up in the chemo part of it, which if you look at this, consider cancer being the space above the ground, chemo is like dropping a neutron bomb at 10,000 feet. It's just going to kill everything. Radiation is a bit more specific, but still whole brain radiation is no bargain. And also the directly focused radiation is also going to kill some good cells. Surgery, always the best. If you can cut something out without metastasis, then you're count yourself lucky. But I think that the part of the equation that's ignored is what's beneath the water, the ice, whatever you want to think of it. Beneath the ground, you know, you do have this natural killer and T-cell defense system, which is constantly looking for your own cells that are affected by cancer and killing them, and it's very good at that. Before that, every cell has P53, which is its own little internal monitoring. And if something is awry with the chromosomes, you know, it's going to kill that cell or at least prevent it from dividing, which obviates which makes it impossible for cancer to even exist. But the biggest part of the cancer equation is here, in my opinion, telomere protection. Because people think that cancer is something that's handed down from, you know, the gods, or it's a genetic thing. But in truth, you have the ability to get cancer of every organ. And if you live long enough, 250, you will get cancer of every organ. So it's not the kind of disease that you would think, like rabies or, you know, cholera. This is just accumulated damage to your genetics, and it really cannot be helped. Normally, when the telomeres get too short, the cell thinks of it as DNA break, and it heals them. You get these double chromosomes, and then you're in trouble because it can't segregate properly. And what I mean by that is the cards are dealt. You don't get an even distribution across both sides. This comes from a lung cancer. Look, there's three copies of 13. You got a double chromosome here, and you get all these color bands. They're from translocations. So this amazing dance has to happen so many billion times in your a day, and for the most part, it happens faithfully, and you don't get a problem. But it's just a matter of time before you get every cancer, unless you have the mechanisms working. But I think that's really all I wanted to say about this. What does Tracy want to add?
Hold on, and I'll get her. Hello.
Hi, Tracy.
Hi, how are you?
Good, Dr. Clark. I know we haven't spoken, but we did talk about you a little bit and the fact that you had known Dr. Wilson and, you know, kind of were asking Mom to try TA-65.
You know, she has that science-based mind, so
right.
She wants the facts and the proof.
Mm-hmm.
And so, yeah, she wasn't into it by any means.
Yeah.
Not, yeah.
And so now, looking at the before and after, how do you, I mean, she looks so young. Is that just the lighting, or does she seem healthy as she appears in the picture?
Yeah, no, she does look really young, actually. She's kind of been lucky like that anyway. And she is doing really well. Like, yeah, she feels pretty good. I think considering the circumstances, you know, this is my first time through lung cancer, so or really through being so close to anyone with cancer, you know, through the treatment. But she seems to be, I mean, she does really well. Like, we go out and have lunch all the time, or we'll go shopping. I mean, she doesn't last a very long time, but, I mean, her energy is remarkable for what someone with cancer you'd expect to see.
Yeah.
So the energy is really good. Her attitude is really good about it. You know, she's very positive. And, you know, she's very involved with the family and, like, the everyday stuff that, you know, your family goes through.
That's fantastic. You know, I know people always say that they would hate to die of cancer, but in some ways I think it's much better than dying of other ways because, let's say you get hit by a car, you never get to say the things you want to say to your loved ones. But cancer has a way of focusing your mind and your pursuits. You really understand there's a gift of knowing what's important, and I think it's just kind of enhances your appreciation, obviously.
I would agree. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
definitely. I mean, you're right. If you get by a car, you're done. You don't have that opportunity. So, yeah, this is a great opportunity. And it's, I mean, I can understand why someone would say, I would hate to die of cancer, because you just look at it like you just get sick and you're unable to interact with life on a daily basis. And that has not been our experience. I mean, she's really involved with us.
Well, for whatever reason, you know, the brain metastasis, the tumor in her lung seemed to be well under control. And I'm sure if it stayed that way, she wouldn't mind having cancer for the rest of her life. Right? If there's no symptoms.
Right.
Just like people live with HIV and non-detectable HIV counts. It's all about the T-cell system. It's all about your immune system. And that seems to be healing her in some way.
Mm-hmm.
She looks
amazing.
Did she get a lot of colds this winter? I know last year she couldn't even leave the house, or in 2009. Was she sick a lot?
I don't think so. No. Like, we've had a flu that's run through all the rest of the kids. She hasn't got it. And all the rest of us have been sick. So, no, I don't think so. Mm-mm.
Good. Well,
yeah.
Thank you for sharing this with Jackie. She's an amazing person, and I'm really happy to see she's doing well.
Yeah, she's doing really well. And she, I mean, really to have changed her perspective or belief on this has been, that in itself is amazing, you know, because she was so being in the Western medicine mindset for so long and being a nurse for 30 plus years, you know, and then I'm like, Mom, no, I really think you should try this. And then actually seeing it work for someone who was like a non-believer from the beginning, that's the really cool part.
And to be fair, just for everyone, we're not treating cancer with this. This is a nutraceutical. It has a medical benefit, we believe, but primarily through helping your own immune system, which is hopefully fighting the cancer.
Exactly. Yes, helping your body take care of itself. Right.
So,
great.
All right. Thank you so much.
Yeah, of course. Anytime. Good luck. And if you guys need anything else, you know, feel free. Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Okay, so we're at 40 minutes, so we should probably wrap up at this point. Is there anything else that you want to share with people who may be considering recommending this to somebody or trying it with or without cancer? I mean, what would you say to journey?
You know, the biggest thing that I can say is the difference between how I felt with the first chemotherapy session and the second chemotherapy session was like night and day. Taking the TA-65 with the chemotherapy, I was not run down to the ground like I was the first time. If for no other reason, I would recommend it just to help alleviate the side effects of the chemo. It's amazing how much different you feel. And the way that I explain it is you keep loading your body up with this toxic substance and never giving it a chance to recover. And the TA-65 helps it to, you know, recover as it's being beaten. You know, as your cells are getting beaten up, the TA-65 helps to rejuvenate the good ones, which I think is very important.
It's like, so, you know, you have a hostage situation, but instead of poisoning everybody, you go in and you make everyone stronger, and the good guys do outnumber the bad guys, so hopefully your immune system figures out what it can do. And if it be divine intervention, placebo effect, I'm pretty happy with how you're turning out.
Oh, yeah, I'm very pleased. I'm very pleased. I've gotten 6 months more than what I was supposed to get, and I'm still doing okay, so I'm hoping to get it third year.
Right?
Yeah.
I was telling your daughter that if you feel this good, even with cancer, it's not the same as what you would have envisioned. You know, having cancer, you would take it, right? I mean,
right.
You can have no symptoms, no growth or metastasis, and live your life. You wouldn't mind being a cancer victim or person.
Exactly. And I think that, you know, mindset is a very important part of it, where I don't look at it as, oh my gosh, I'm somebody with cancer. I look at it as, okay, I have cancer and I have to work around that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, continue to live your life. Just, you know, it's there, but you're not going to define your life by it.
Yeah. And I remember we spoke just real briefly. You had that amazing story about the gentleman, you know, the one out of 1,000 who did get better because of his dog.
Right.
Can you share that story with us a little bit if you want? Or?
Oh, sure. I was the charge nurse in cardiovascular ICU, and we had gotten a patient who had bypass surgery and unfortunately had developed every complication that you could get from the surgery. He was normally our stays in the cardiovascular ICU were about 3 days, and he had been there for close to 3 months. And he had reached the point, he was still on the ventilator and very weak, and he had reached the point where he even just stopped interacting with the staff. We'd go in and talk to him. He wouldn't even open his eyes. He wouldn't do anything. And I had come in one day, and another patient had passed away, and his wife was hysterical. And unfortunately, the headline on the paper in the paper that day was how nurses are killing their patients. And what it was referring to was that nurses are overworked and that kind of stuff. But she was waving this paper in the air and screaming, "You killed my husband, you killed my husband." And as the charge nurse, I had to deal with her and get her calmed down. And by this time, I was very frustrated. And I went into, I was taking care of the man with the poor outcome from surgery. And I was talking to him, and he wouldn't acknowledge my presence. He wouldn't squeeze my hand. He wouldn't open his eyes. He wouldn't do anything. And my professionalism, normally I would have just let it go and talked to him and just kept talking. But I was so frustrated that day, I just said to him, "Okay, Mr. So-and-so, this is the fact. You are going to die. And you're going to die because you have given up and you're not trying anymore. And there's nothing I can do if you aren't willing to live." Mm. And he opened his eyes and looked at me. I said, "So you let me know, what is the one thing that I can do for you before you die?" And he pointed to a picture of his dog. Mm. And this was back before pet therapy was a popular thing. And so I told him, "Okay, you want to see your dog?" And I went out and called his family, and I said, "Bring the dog in." We snuck him in through the dock on the back of the hospital and all the back hallways and got the dog up to his room. And that dog just was licking his face and was so excited to see him. And, you know, we let him visit for about an hour, hour and a half, and then the family took the dog home. And I was off for the next 2 days. And when I came back on the third day, here he was off the ventilator, sitting up in a chair, and he was waving at me as I was coming down the hall. And, you know, it's stuff like that that you think, such a simple thing. You know, just tell somebody where they are in their recovery process, yeah, and let them know that they have to take some responsibility for getting better.
Absolutely. But knowing what we know, especially where you were working, people come with a lot of false hope. They come thinking, "Well, I guess there's a secret," and this positive thinking. Well, no. You know, you have a disease that needs to be treated medically. And I think that's part of the whole resistance. I mean, you get a guy like Steve McQueen or Steve Jobs. They go try different therapies. Yeah, it's nice to have a belief and a faith, and the body can heal a lot. But the dog,
right,
the guy with the dog is the one in the thousand, right? That's the exception that proves the rule.
It is. It is. It is. I was just, you know, you have to wonder what the cosmos are telling you, you know, when you do something like that and it has such a positive impact. Mm-hmm. And you think at the time you did it, I mean, as soon as the words came out of my mouth, I was like, "Oh, yeah, why did I say that?" Oh. But, you know, sometimes you just need to be blunt and honest.
Right. Well, there's a guy who was keeping himself sick for whatever reason, right?
Exactly.
He just didn't want to do his part. But no amount of, you know, positive thinking or visualization is going to take care of a small cell carcinoma that's extended
right,
stage, right? I mean,
right.
That's why you were kind of, I think, resistant to the whole idea of TA-65, because you put it in that whole faith healing category. Probably.
Right. Yeah, I was definitely of the mindset that, you know, the toxic medications are the only thing that's going to have any effect, and it's not going to leave me feeling good, and I just kind of resigned myself to having this agonizing death, essentially. But fortunately, that's not how it's working out.
Yes. Yes, and we never know how it's going to work out. I could get out of, literally, you know, I could get hit by a bus and never have a chance to apologize to my wife for the things I said to her this morning. that's a chance I'll take. But it's been wonderful speaking with you. Really have enjoyed it. And I'm looking forward
to
next week's results. Will you tell us what's going on with that?
I sure will. I'll keep you updated.
Super, fantastic. All right. Oh, I don't know. You know, there are people, if you want to ask calls, if you want to ask questions, you can type them in or raise a flag on the top left, web attendees. If anybody has a question for Jackie, be happy to take that. Is that okay? Do you have time?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Okay. Anybody want to type in a question in the chat or raise a flag? I will unmute you, and then still have a couple of dozen people on the call. No? Okay, looks like we have no takers. Check the list.
Okay.
Perfect. Okay, my friends, very good. So I'll be editing this, and I will get a nice edited version and get back to you with that, okay?
Okay, great.
All right, Jackie. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
All right, this is Dr. Ed Park signing off. Our guest has been registered nurse Jackie Close, and she has shared her amazing journey with us, and the topic was lung cancer. So be sure and go to my blog and sign up for future topics. There's going to be a lot of more interesting testimonials and different topics, so hope you can participate. All right. Bye, Jackie.
Bye-bye.